know about pedagogy and you know, and outreach programs, and having them help not the nine of you create some of the things here shows that you're really able to solve a problem throughout, because there are only selected people throughout the planet to deal with it.
Robert and I were talking about master's classes, which at a postgraduate level all over Europe, I'm sure there'd be people who are, you know, like you say, there's one person in every university doing a PhD in that thing, I bet. And so you get 15 of those, and obviously there would be a fee.
Well, we want more structural relations.
Yeah.
Like that. Mm-hmm. Not, not, they're a bit too ad hoc maybe at this moment.
Mm-hmm. I've written more for my PhD. So, yeah, but I have to try. I was asked about a blog thing. So I was getting lots of ideas. Some of them weren't related to what my PhD is in, but some of them were. And if I could write at that speed at home, I mean, my thesis would come together a lot quicker. So the idea of saying, well, you know, there's other people who I know are researching things similar to what I'm doing. And in a sense, the microchambery was like that. You know, it brought a lot of people together. It was broad. But if you did do events in the future, so, you know, either master's students or postgraduate students, where you say, well, there's a theme that we know a lot of people are researching, maybe only one in every location around the world, but we're going to bring everyone together for 3 days. And yes, there's going to be a fee, but I mean, I have, I'm lucky I got funding for my PhD, but also as part of that, I've got money that I have to spend by the end of each academic year, because it's to send myself to conferences.
Can you send us an email like 2 months before that happens?
Oh, it is.
It's like you were up for pushing.
Yeah,
but I think, I mean, you, another way of looking at it was to have an ongoing, one of the things I would like to see is to see a sort of a ever-changing group of people who are literally just coming here for 1 week, 2 weeks, getting a studio upstairs like you have for writing, and just actually writing together and bouncing ideas
to
each other. I think that even instead of doing an annual thing, I would love to see people come for a month, for 2 weeks, for 1 week, for 2 months, and come and write. Particularly for those of you guys who are sitting and writing theses, and I think it could be, you could maybe, if you want to control it, you might want to control it between what kind of stage of a process you're in.
Yeah.
So, for example, you could imagine that a group of people who are thesis writing have different needs than a group of people who are literature reviewing. But you know, something like that is something that would benefit us enormously, just bringing these conversations in the house.
Cat beds.
Yeah.
All you need
is
cat beds up there, and you can have bedroom studio. I've got a window in there.
We could have like 50 people sleeping right here.
This is camp.
Well, that was actually what I thought when I first heard about Jamboree a few years ago. That's what I...
Your association?
You know, my association with Jamboree was a bunch of RVs and people lying out in sleeping bags.
You did grow up in rural, Kevin.
I did.
Okay,
what role could STEM play in more formalized educational structures?
One thing I think that maybe that's my position, one thing that I think is going wrong is the communication between research in this type of fields and actual applications. I think academic field is very much doing its own academic thing, and entertainment, because I think in the end music is entertainment, even if it's, you know, not immediate pop music, but people still go to concert to be entertained in a certain way. Entertainment can turn out to be entertaining in an unpleasant kind of way.
Entertainment.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think I'm not sure the results of academic research into this kind of field really come through to the people who would actually be using this kind of thing, musicians. I think there's like a link missing there. I think there is too little the entertainment world experiences, in a wider sense of that word, I experience the academic world as being, you know, inaccessible. I think the academic world isn't sufficiently aware that if you're researching this kind of thing, then it would really be quite nice if your research would actually be applied. Because otherwise it's, yes, you did something beautiful, go do something else. But then where, it's almost like some people sometimes seem to be like building houses, which then stand there and everybody appreciates the architecture, but nobody actually starts living there. And eventually, I suppose these weird squatters move in, where I suppose. But I think actually that kind of translating role is the kind of that it's like this spot in between entertainment and academics. It's kind of the spot where Stein is standing in, from my perspective, and there should be like a communications channel, right? You know, going through Stein, and I'm not really sure. It's there. I think that's, I'm not sure how that role would work, and I wasn't sure exactly how you would make a profit from this market that I think is there, but I think that there is a need for that, and I think Stein is in a perfect spot to do that, pretty much as a translator.
Between artists and academics?
Well, between the artistic world and the academic world, yes. Yeah,
I think you're correct in the fact that is the bigger, it used to be a divide between art and technology, and I don't see that divide like that anymore. I think it's much more an art divide between academia and practice or music.
Yeah.
And things are mixed up otherwise.
I agree with what you're saying. A lot of research, you look at stuff and perhaps you look at the way it sounds, and so I just can't see how that ever is going to become relevant to the wider public who consume music or listen to music. But I disagree in a sense that academic research has led, in terms of DSP.
Yes, of course it has. Of course it
and
has.
It
yes.
takes it takes really out there, you know, bands that people, you know, not many people listen to Allsacker, but they've taken, you know, stuff and they've had this. They made some great albums and stuff, and slowly over time, you know, a glitch aesthetic became. Now it's almost cliche to do electro glitch, and all of that stuff. I mean, maybe it's applied more rhythmically, but you know, the granular synthesis stuff, the FFT based stuff that's been done, and now you can just pick it up in a plugin. You don't even have to have any skill, you know, to do it with. So academic does filter into real world stuff.
Yes, of course.
I think
it just takes 10 years.
No. But if there's a different model there as well. This is the clear model, you know, where you invent something at a theoretical level and that is then applied. I think, you know, we could be much more interesting. What is a place that applies stuff that is, you know, that is, you know, invented somewhere else? But exactly because we work from the performance situation, that generates its own questions, and it generates its own kind of research.
So you're more interested in feeding upwards into where the research could go next on an academic side, based on the needs of.
I would see it as a collaborative process as well. You know, I don't see us applying things, but you know, it's quite a fundamental issue. Like in Holland, it's one of all the art schools are, you know, thinking about what would PhDs be in art, rather than, you know, theoretical research. And you know, then there's this whole discussion of the creation of something is another method of learning.
Yeah, that's,
you know, you can develop a theory and then apply it, or you can make something and then learn from what you made. And there are just different approaches to knowledge.
Research, but that's happening in academia.
It is definitely happening. It's a matter of you end up sometimes.
Well, let me ask you, it could be an interesting context for practice-based research programs.
Yeah, definitely.
We'd love to be there. You know. So, if any of you are involved in these kinds of discussions, think of us, because we would love to host, you know, practical-based research PhDs here. You know,
get a lot of people from England then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's
a real fad,
that whole practice-based research trade.
No, it's a very, you know.
But it's timely here simply because we don't don't have it at this point in Holland. And there's this ongoing discussion.
Creative industries, is that also just starting in Holland as well?
Oh, no. We unfortunately came up with that and sent that to you. You guys are sending the other stuff to us. It's a sort of evil exchange. But there is it's an ongoing discussion that's happening right now. And it's really, really acute, very, very acute in Holland. So it makes a lot of sense for us to look at England, to look at Norway, to look at
Finland.
Belgium also has a certain model. So it makes a lot of sense to look at that because we're already doing the crossover.
Right. Do approaches if you have,
I think it's a great idea. Yeah. I mean, I know a lot of PhD students in performance who have to create their entire context for the performances in order to do their research.
You can save a research student so much time when I think about that radio thing that I made that over my first year. It took me about a year to kind of bring from undergraduate and something admittedly different, but even then I had a fair amount of electronic knowledge. I had to teach myself the Arduino, I had to teach myself sort of hardware hacking. And all I wanted was just to use I didn't want to break the radio, and all I wanted was sensor data out of it. So I knew it's not that hard, and it should be possible. And I did it, and it took 2 months. If I'd known about some of my lifestyle back then, and I didn't know, then I knew I could come there and get told, I didn't even spend my, not in front of Ben, but I didn't spend the £700 I got in the first year because I didn't know it didn't roll over. So at the end of it, so there's, at least for researchers, there's opportunities to travel. And if you could do in 3 days, teach me, have taught me about that, it would help my research, it would help other people.
It would definitely make our position stronger, whoever judges us, if we could say, we are, we have a formal relationship with, 5 universities because they send their PhD students to us because we are the context that they thrive in. That's a good argument for anybody.
You could. The other way to do that, of course, is to create staff PhDs.
But you can't because you can't award them.
You can't award them. That's true.
This is where we get stuck in the best system.
Yeah. No, but the way you could do it is be a partner on a European 57 grant or something, and then have PhDs that are resident here but are paid by.
Well,
that's true.
There's also sources. I mean, we have. I mean, Robin doesn't know about this, but I didn't know about the £700 you left. We actually have £5,000 for students to do 1 year of their PhD, right? So they do 3 years of PhD, they can do their second year somewhere else. And I know several universities have that. Have that program. So there are those programs there. I like the fact that Stein doesn't offer PhDs because it's come up today. You are autonomous. You're not a university. You're not a company.
I didn't mean to insinuate that you would award them, but you could have a granting system.
You could host
higher PhDs.
We can host them. I think hosting is the word. And it's exactly this is exactly this is for us. It's very important. We'd like to stay autonomous, but collaborate with everybody.
But it should make sense. Visible. Remember this: if you have any kind of person coming into here doing a project, there's a benefit for this person. Mm-hmm. What's the benefit for Stein if it's not visible anywhere?
It
also, in regard to people who decide on funding you or something, there should be a whole list of the people that have been here.
We're
coming here.
Yeah, we're definitely lacking there, and we need to ask more of the people that come here. To document their own work and to leave their traces behind that we can show to whoever's judging.
Well, that's the outcome of one of the outcomes of this. It's really tangible. I mean, that you do that, that you do it by date, that you may even get some ethnomusicologists musicologists. Maybe there is an aspect of that. Musicologists involved in putting that together. But I mean, I think people would, if you had a website that just was year by year and you saw the projects, I would be fascinated to see, 1978, what the heck were people working on then here,
Or one of those excellent maps like the membership of Jethro Tull.
Oh, yes, exactly. You realize that there's only about 10 people that know that.
We had a master's student.
Yes?
I don't know. We had a master's student who went through all the annual reports and figured out who had been guests and plastered, basically wallpapered one of our entire studios with the lists by year.
You did it already?
Well, somebody did for their...
For only a part, I think.
He only ended up having to do only a part, because otherwise he would have been sort of stuck in our basement.
But it was for a master thesis, and he finished it. It's in German, so that's...
But it was very, very nice because we would, whenever he wasn't here, we would still use the studio and guests would come and they'd just be like standing there looking at these
absolutely.
Tiny
yeah,
print
yeah.
lists
absolutely.
Of people.
Yeah.
We'd also
yeah.
avoid so many mistakes that the new generation makes. You see, this has been done in 82, this,
yeah.
just
yeah.
this chronological thing.
Yeah.
I would love to have our archive online.
And it's cheap. I think it's not that's a big investment.
It's expensive in time.
You put this master thesis students on it, so
yeah.
you can get it in the time, you can get it from people that have their own profit doing it.
If any of you have students who would be interested in helping us, you know, because it's a lot of work going back through all these years.
Actually, that would also fix sort of the academic under-visibility of Stein, which I think is also a shame. I mean, I think a lot of people sort of miss out on things they could have learned from Stein projects and
yeah.
sort of reinvent wheels that have been done here
yeah.
a long time
yeah.
ago.
That does take you, I think, reaching out to those to those departments and like sending that first email that says we're interested in you helping us in that way.
Mm-hmm.
I think because that's not obvious from the outside. I don't think that you would want an identity department intruding on your history. You have to kind of ask for that.
Yeah.
I would say you are asking for it in this room, but you should probably do that elsewhere as well.
Yeah.
It would also just, you know, that it would save. We had this discussion just a few minutes before this of the annoying NIM talks that have absolutely no perspective prior to year 2000. I mean, nothing happened before the year 2000. Everything's been invented more recently. And just being able to point to a website and say, look, you know, this was done in 1982 and again before that, and you know, which isn't a bad thing, but at least have the perspective that you're not the first in walking this path.
Reclaim history.
And part of that history, I think, is also its relation to media arts, which is generally not ignored, but perhaps underrepresented by musicians. And that's a shame. I mean, I think now that media arts would really like to know what Stein has done in the last 100 years. It's a long time.
For me, the thing is, if you don't publish what you've done, it does not exist.
No.
That's the problem.
It's a recording.
But this is a culture shift that's been happening, because traditionally Stein only existed in the performance of
yes.
So that's a little bit what we're dealing with. It's such an enormous backlog
of
undigitized tapes and cardboard box. You would not believe.
Yeah.
It's
your task to sort out those tapes and say those 20, 30 are the most important. They have to be put online within the coming time.
Published in an own...
That's how you...
Highlights first.
Yeah.
On the edition.
Stein sessions on that stuff. Yeah, for the 40th anniversary, you say this music from Stein, you can dug out the archive.
If you want good quality, then go to the Stein website.
Yeah, yeah.
Like that.
I have great euphonic workshop CDs, and in the UK we lament the fact that BBC got rid of the radio workshop, but left this legacy, and you know, now people are writing articles about it. Certainly when I went downstairs and looked at that gear and they've got analog synths down there that are not just ones that other people have made, they've got totally custom ones that are custom built to the place. I think, you know, if there was a website with photos of that details,
you
can
take your
camera
in there, it's okay.
I would waste more time than I already do looking at stuff like that on the internet, you know, looking at that.
shouldn't do.
Be careful with FP7. It will tend to pull you in directions that money is.
FP7?
The framework.
Kind of a contentious framework.
Well, no, it's just that
the
framework fund, the funds that come, FP7 is the framework 7 funds, and they tend, I have seen a lot of people become very mercenary. They follow the money. And so what you're doing today is trying to find out for the next 4 years, what's the direction of Stein? And I think that's a fantastic approach. And if there happens to be framework money, that's appropriate with where
for you're that going, direction.
For that direction, then I would say absolutely go for it, but do not follow the money there, because it will lead you, you'll be doing things for nuclear reactors and human interface computing.
We'd rather fold our cards than go off and not be us.
Yeah, so that's what I would not do.
Good, that's it, good.
Then become an academic institution, and that would change everything. It's nice feeling like I'm not in an academic institution, but then knowing I can go back to that environment to do more work. But it's nice, it's invigorating. So while you might partner up, have students come over and stuff,
we want to be a safe house more than we want to be an escape place.
I think that would be that would be more attractive to people writing with, writing or making, whatever stage, a PhD or a master's. The idea is somewhere you could do work that is different. There's lots of other people who are already doing this. There's conference workshops. I like the fact that before I came, I couldn't really tell people from what I really know what I was going to do when I was there, because it wasn't an academic course then. Otherwise, we get sent.
Which you did let me go.
She let me go.
Will you keep the lab, the hardware development side of it? Do you have plans for that?
We don't have plans for that. I can see us maybe focusing a bit more on the artistic coaching than on the hardware development and the hardware invention. But we're not going to sell the hardware lab now.
What are you going to do with all this?
There's actually a risk that Jorgen will leave us because. And then he's going to take with him a lot of these things.
So keep up the hardware department.
There's no way.
But we might not, try to develop an alternative Arduino. What we're trying to say, because we don't think that would be a smart thing.
And build your expertise, for example, with such a platform that everybody knows how to use and think more of,
there's a wealth of knowledge in that room, when I spoke to him, he knows how to build stuff. And when I started designing instruments originally when I was 17, and I had a variable and capacitors and resistors, and I was trying to build stuff, and I didn't know at the time about programs. I didn't have a laptop or a computer that could run anything like React or Max, so I was building all this stuff, and I found out about that. And now I'm coming back. And I don't want a laptop, I don't want a computer. And I think there's lots of other, when I speak to other people I make music with, the reason the Zoxbox is so cool, and you see them, people wait on the waiting list for ages to get on, they'll pay crazy money on eBay for one someone else has already made, is because,
should we do a design a synthesizer competition? We'll build the winner.
Actually, and then put it open source. Here's the circuit design.
Make sure it
doesn't cost you anymore. This is too much into a high-quality analog interfaces right now, because it's quite hard to make them profitable.
That's a good news about us not having to be profitable if we do a good job of generating all this other money.
We didn't say we would mass produce this thing. We might
We'll build it,
we'll show how cool it is, and then show the circuits.
And then go to everybody like, we have this in UK.
If you put
online a bill of materials, so you put prices and codes and pictures for every single component, even if it's say 300 components, and a CAD file, then motivated people
will just say, well, I can get that printed, or communities.
Oh, shall the PCB? Because PCB gets much cheaper if you do them in larger numbers. Like doing a single one is spectacularly expensive.
But this is also where the forum would be helpful. Like,
yeah, because that can set the direction of where,
But also, I mean,
But listen, you don't need to worry about making stuff proper. If you're careful with, you know, you're asking people to design and say, if that kind of thing happened, then you build it, so maybe that's like a week or 2 weeks. All you need to do is make sure that you document the entire process.
Yeah, because it's more, it's more about the process.
Yeah, it is about the winning process. Yeah. But then other people, you know, if you say, this crackle box has been so popular, why can't new things come about?
Because times have changed. You know, there's a difference between then and now. I can see that. You know, I
don't know. I see your boxes, and I would, I think I would love
to. Those are like conceptual art pieces.
No, that's true.
There's no sense in which I would ever sell those. I have no desire to put more shit in the world than necessary.
But the fact that they exist and the fact that the physicality changes them.
The reason you're building them in the first place.
I don't know, this hardware discussion sort of baffles me, to be honest, because it doesn't seem like you guys want to spend your time putting resistors in the little pieces, little plastic bags and selling.
We want to host a discussion of, what is
as far as the sale outfit for kits and things.
That's
not terrible.
Maybe somebody else will do that.
What does Taku think?
That's
right, baby.
Come in here, you're on camera.
I'm ready to get some drinks.
Right on. My brother.
It's great that we have this. I mean, this is our community. This is our circle of friends. And as Yolandi put it, we're harvesting ideas.
Parasitic.
We need to get some energy in our stomachs, so there's going to be some free drinks and soup and quiche there. And it's been a great 4 days for us especially. And we will have the concert later on, which will be hopefully festive. If you guys are okay, I'd like to wrap this session up.
I have one more question. Who of you thinks, that we should charge 70 euros for junction?
How much?
70. We charge 70, right? 70.
Yeah.
70? 70. 70. 70. 70. 70. 70. 70. 70. 70. 70. 70.
70. 70. 70. 70. 70. 70.
70. 70. 70. 70. 70. 70.
70. 70. 70. 70.
Okay, now the final thing I want to use is totally embarrassed. Taco, would you please come up into the main here?
Thank you.